Does quinolinate being high-ish without xanthorenate and kynurenate being high-ish, or even on the low side, indicate an issue with niacin or inflammation instead of B6? Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind, or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. All right, Alicia C. says, does a pattern of in-range but lowish Genova urine kynurenate and xanthorenate and highish quinolinate and picolinate make you think less about B6 and more about niacin production or inflammation? I'm having trouble getting a doctor's order for the HDRI niacin number test, and thus I'm wondering if any hints on niacin could be gleaned from these organic acid test markers. So for anyone listening now or later during the further distribution of the video, just as some background here, kynurenate, xanthorenate, and quinolinate are three tryptophan metabolites that are sequentially produced on the pathway that can either be used to synthesize niacin or vitamin B3 from tryptophan, or can be used for the complete combustion of tryptophan in the citric acid cycle. And so, generally speaking, this pathway is not regulated by the need for niacin and is regulated by the need to completely dispose of tryptophan. However, it is regulated by estrogen, and so I do think it's possible and poorly recognized that estrogen acts as a signal for the need for niacin, and that in women, there is some degree of regulation according to the need for niacin, whereas in men, there's not, and that the typical textbook explanation that it's not regulated by the need for niacin might be derived from research being sort of biased towards the way it works in males. And then inflammation also upregulates this pathway. So estrogen and inflammation are the two things that upregulate the pathway. Now, the question would be why? So typically what you see in vitamin B6 is needed at three steps during this pathway. And those are the steps that metabolize kynurenate, xanthorenate, and quinolinate. And typically, you would see xanthorenate and kynurenate being elevated earlier in B6 deficiency, and you would need a more severe B6 deficiency to see quinolinate. But Alicia is asking about the sort of opposite, the inverse of that. Why would the xanthorenate and kynurenate be on the lower side, whereas the quinolinate being on the higher side in that series? Now, I think, you know, you're saying lowish and highish. I think it's possible that these just don't mean anything really. So, you know, if something's not out of the range and if it's not real close to the range on these markers, particularly with Genova's range, you know, because Genova's using like a tighter definition of normal than what you would get on a bigger, you know, a bigger sort of conventional lab already. And so if these are like, you know, if you're talking about like second quintile versus fourth quintile, it might not mean anything. You know, by contrast, if it's getting close to the edges of the ranges and then they keep diverging so that, you know, it looks like you're progressively on your way to xanthorenate and kynurenate just getting lower and lower and quinolinate getting higher and higher, then that probably does mean something. But I don't really see why that would changed the interpretation to, you know, away from B6 and towards inflammation or niacin, because as far as I know, and this might be, maybe this just reflects, you know, that I don't know enough about the details of how this pathway can be differentially regulated. But as far as I know, inflammation and estrogen are basically just going to upregulate the pathway starting at the top. And so they're going to funnel more tryptophan through the pathway. But if the reason that quinolinate is going up is because more tryptophan is being funneled through the pathway due to inflammation or estrogen, then that doesn't really help explain why quinolinate and xanthorinate aren't elevated at all. Whereas I think the reason B6 tends to act in that sequential order is probably because of the relative affinity of the enzymes for B6. So it's probably just the case that the lower enzymes in the pathway that metabolize the quinolinate have a higher affinity for B6. And so that is what makes you need a higher degree of deficiency in order to see the quinolinate rise typically. So you know, and with niacin, you would think if there's something downstream from this pathway impacting niacin production, like let's say not niacin production is inhibited, I don't see why that would raise quinolinate specifically, because the normal use of this pathway is not to make niacin. It's actually to completely break down tryptophan and metabolize it in the citric acid cycle. So I don't think any of those things really offer a good explanation. I think it's quinolinate does have excitatory effects as a neurotransmitter. So I think it's possible that there might be regulation on that basis. So, you know, you might be trying to gain excitatory effects from the quinolinate in some kind of regulated fashion. Or you might just have an idiosyncratic manifestation of those markers. You know, just because you typically see quinolinate rise last doesn't mean that it's going to rise last in everyone. And so, you know, to summarize, I think I would first look at how divergent these are. So again, if you're looking at like, if by highest and lowest, you mean second and fourth quintile, then I wouldn't read too much into it. But if it really seems like the quinolinate is on its way out of the range and the xanthorinate and quinolinate are in the first quintile and they're either going nowhere, or it looks like, you know, over two tests, they keep going lower and lower. So you actually have a real divergence. If either of those things are true, then I would say you might want to interpret it as being meaningful, but I don't see why niacin production, inflammation, or estrogen should offer any coherent explanation for why that pattern would diverge. It could just be idiosyncratic and you might need more B6 period, in which case you might want to measure your plasma B6 and see what that says. And you might also want to just see if supplementing with B6 changes those markers. Or could be something regulated deliberately on the for your balance of neurotransmitters, in which case I don't know what to do about that, but that might, you know, offer some explanatory power. So anyway, I hope that helps, Alicia. Thank you for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.